It's my privilege this morning to get to introduce our guest pastor of the day. Reverend Eric Davis, a Starkville native, graduated with a Bachelor of Science from Mississippi College before pursuing his theological education at Asbury Theological Seminary in Wilmer, Kentucky. After graduating with a Master's of Divinity from ATS, Eric became the Associate Minister at Louisville United Methodist Church. In 2016, Eric began serving as the senior pastor at Memorial United Methodist Church in Bolton, Mississippi. He also began teaching Bible at Hines Community College, and he launched the Wesley Campus Ministry on the Raymond campus of Hines Community College. Eric is married to Christine Davis, and together they have a 2-year-old son, and they welcomed their baby girl Emily this past September. Please welcome Eric.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. On behalf of the board at USM Wesley Foundation and the students, it is a privilege to be here among you this morning. And as Angela talked about, I feel like I've already been here. I feel like I'm at home and just watching everybody laugh and have fun. That's a good thing. That's a joyful thing in the house of the Lord. So thank you for welcoming myself, and hopefully next time my wife and kids will make the trip over. So thank you for being who you are this morning, and let's give God glory each and every day. I think today, as I made my way over and praying about this service and making my steps this way, thinking about those that have come with me, if you will, in memory, and today being a day where we celebrate veterans, I think about my grandfather, someone that served in World War II, and then coming back home, serving the church there at Foster's Chapel United Methodist Church right outside of West Point, Mississippi. And just making sure that the space, that the church was ready for people to come and celebrate and worship by having the lights on and the heat on, the doors open. And that's a special thing, a memory for me. This morning, I think is the 11 o'clock service, you get the joy of anything I missed in the 9, I correct here and fix it. So they were the test, and you guys will get it right this time. So thank you. If you will, let's hear the word of the Lord. It comes from Mark chapter 9. And it's verses 30 through 37. They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were. Because he was teaching his disciples, he said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet because on the road they had been arguing about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all." He took a child whom he placed among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, after the 9 o'clock service, Hoppy kind of pulled me off to the side, and he said, "Hey, just, you know, get everybody up to speed with what the Wesley Foundation is." So I'll just do that real quick, and I'm gonna ask, if you will, if you're a board member, Lauren and Hoppy, if you'll just raise your hand. They are board members for the Wesley Foundation, and the Wesley Foundation is a stepping stone for college students as they leave the local church and make their way to a campus. So USM, Ole Miss, and even at Hines, we had a Wesley Foundation. And basically, it's a community for college students. And you empower these ministries to happen. Here in Mississippi Annual Conference, we are the only annual conference that not only has university Wesley Foundations, but we also have community college Wesley Foundations. That is a beautiful thing. That is a beautiful thing. So, Oak Grove, UMC, thank you. It's without you that we couldn't do what we do at USM. And as I told Purvis a few weeks ago, I said, I can promise you one thing. We will teach, we will preach, and we will go out and make disciples, sending them around the world.
and it's a joyful thing that we get to do. If you would like to, after the service, pull me aside and say, hey, tell me a little bit more, or I have a grandchild, or I know somebody on campus, please give me their information, and I'll be glad to reach out to them and get them plugged into our ministry. So before I ever begin to preach or even teach or start a service, I like to claim that it is a space for grace to happen. I want you to hear that and hear those words. It's a space for grace to happen. This is a space in which we come seeking God's grace. This is a space where we come and say, God, you're going to do something in our midst, and I know that this is a safe space for you to move. That this is the church, this is where you are glorified, and you are doing something new in me. It's a space for grace to happen. Today we have our text in the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 9, and it's a beautiful thing right here at chapter 9. And something happens. You know, the disciples are always having conversations with each other, maybe behind Jesus' back or maybe even with Jesus. And they're always pondering things I feel like you and I ponder. They're always thinking and having conversations I feel like we often ask ourselves. This day, they made their way through Galilee and they made their way to Capernaum, and they were arguing. Can you believe it? Arguing. They were arguing about something, and it was, who is the greatest? And they were arguing about who is the greatest among the disciples. And they're arguing about it, and they're asking, and they're prodding, and maybe you and I do the same. Now, as I was preparing for this sermon, and this I was preparing a few weeks ago, it was right after the events happened on a Saturday at the synagogue. And then that previous week, some events happened that week. And we had just had a 12 hours of prayer at the Wesley Foundation. And we at our prayer station, we had the globe. We had the world. And at that prayer station, students were going for 12 hours, 30 minutes at a time, to pray for the world, to pray for our country, to pray for our campus, to pray for our community. And one of the students on that Friday, as we kind of debriefed our 12 hours of prayer, she said, I'm really wrestling with this praying for our country. I feel like we really need to pray for our country and to pray for our community here at USM and pray for our students that are going through life and in this world and how it likes to rear its ugly head at us. And then Saturday happened. And for me as a campus minister, how do I answer, or how do I speak this good word when this world is raising its ugly head? And when we see things like we see those events take place, even just this past week, for me, I know that something just stirs in my heart and in my soul. Something stirs so deeply because of what God has done and what God is doing. I'm a product of this generation. There's a movie that you might have seen, you might have heard this quote, and maybe you'll go watch the movie after this. And the famous Ricky Bobby, he says a quote in his movie, and he says, if you ain't first, you're last. Y'all have heard it. If you ain't first, you're last. And as I read this text and I heard those disciples arguing about who's the greatest, and then Jesus teaching and saying, I just heard Ricky Bobby in the back of my head, if you ain't first, you're last. And I thought, well, that's a little, right? That's a little counterculture. That's a little, you know, backwards, if you will. Jesus has this backward teaching, this backwards kingdom, and I'm hearing Ricky Bobby tell me what the world wants to tell me, what all my friends want to tell me, what my colleagues and my coworkers want to tell me. What I've been taught at school or out in life, if you're not first, you're last. If you're not achieving the best, if you're not stepping on somebody, if you're not getting all that you can, you're last. And then here comes Jesus. Jesus teaching exactly, completely counterculture, what we want to teach ourselves and our friends, or even the way that we want to live. He teaches completely backwards. Aren't you glad? I wrestle with that myself, hearing those words, if you will, Ricky Bobby, and then reading this text, wrestling with status, wrestling with prestige, wrestling with getting all that I can at all cost, achieving and getting fame, or making a name for myself. Have you been there? Have you been in that place where you're trying to do everything that you can so that others are pointing and looking and saying, that's the greatest. They got it. And everybody wants it. They are it. They have the status. Have you been there? Have you found yourself in a place of trying to gain or trying to get it all? And then there's Jesus. What I love about the Gospel of Mark is through the entire Gospel, Jesus is breaking in the kingdom. In the very opening verse, chapter 1, you are told what this book is going to be all about and what this Jesus is going to be all about. His kingdom's breaking in. Get ready. His kingdom is rolling into town. Make straight the paths. Get on board. And then he goes and heals somebody. Do you remember the woman? If she just touches the hem of his garment, if he just touches the hem of his garment, she'll be made well. Do you remember her? That if she just reaches up through the crowd, pushing everybody, touching everybody, making everybody else unclean, if she just touches him, she'll be made well. And what's Jesus' response? Or what about going across to the other side? Getting in the boat with the disciples and Jesus saying, disciples, we got to go across to the other side. There's somebody there that needs us. And the disciples not even asking who is it or what is it. But ending up in a cemetery with a demon-possessed man. And Jesus going to that individual and offering up, if you will, a healing touch. Or what about the leper? That's cast out, that's pushed out on the edges of society and culture, and he's completely marginalized, and Jesus seeing him for the worth he has as a person. And then today in our scripture, right in the midst of them, there's a child. There's a child right there in the midst of them, and it's the 12 disciples, and Jesus sets the child up on his lap. When I'm reading, I ask myself, where'd the child come from? And is he by himself? Of course not. His mom's somewhere nearby. So I have a 2-year-old, and there's one thing that I understand about 2-year-olds is they need adult supervision. James needs extra adult supervision. He loves dinosaurs, fishing, and more dinosaurs. He loves them. He's all about it, and he's go all the time. When I get home today, I'm going to be tired. He's going to go, let's go fishing. And you got to pay extra care for him. You got to give him extra attention. And Jesus knows that. And in our text, Jesus is setting a child in the midst of the disciples and teaching them a teaching point. In his society, there was no care for children. There was no value for children. That's the reality that they lived in. And Jesus sets the child in their midst. A few weeks ago, James was with Christine, and they arrived at the house. They pulled up, and she took Emily in her arm, and James jumped out of that car. And usually, he does not run directly for the pond. That's behind our house. But this day, for some strange reason, he jumped up out of the car and he ran right for that pond. And Christine's wrestling with, how do I do this? I got Emily here and I got to go get James. And as I failed to mention, at 9 o'clock, she got him. He didn't make it to the pond. But children need somebody to watch out for them. Jesus, every step of the way, is showing us what his kingdom is all about. He's illustrating for us that he sees the whole, but he also sees the individual. He sees the person. And he sees the worth in the person. Jesus sees the worth in you. He sees who you are. And he calls you redeemable. Hear me clearly. He calls you redeemable. It's a beautiful thing about Jesus is he is not bound, but yet he is going. He's out on mission. And when you're reading the Gospel of Mark, Jesus has one directive. He is on course. He's got his eyesight. He's got his aim. And he's headed. And he's going. And he's saying, disciples, come with me. I'm already telling you where I'm going. I'm already showing you what the kingdom's all about. You want to achieve success. You want to get status. You want to make a name for yourself. But I'm headed for the cross. I'm going to pay it all. So that as you place faith in me, what's true about me becomes true about you. As you place faith in Jesus, what's true about Jesus becomes true about you. You begin to love God with all you are. You begin to love your neighbor as yourself. And as you and I know, this world needs a whole lot more love. This world needs a whole lot more grace. This world needs a whole lot more peace. And there is only one place that comes from. There is only one place that is the source, and it is dispensed, if you will. We serve a mighty God. We serve an all-powerful God. And He calls you, He calls us into mission and ministry to this world. What I love about campus ministry is I will forever have a crop of people coming through campus every 4 years. And they're all asking who God is and what does God say about me. I think that we're all asking those questions. We see events on TV and we ask ourselves, when's it going to end? We see things in our neighborhoods and we say, how long? But the one beautiful thing that you and I have is good news. It's beautiful news. It's news that transforms the world and communities. It transforms us. It calls us to go to our neighbor. It calls us to offer up reconciliation to our neighbor. It calls us to offer forgiveness to our neighbor. The person that hurt us, the person that's hurting us, the person that's against us, or maybe we're against them. But the gospel calls for us to follow Jesus. And like the disciples that day, to sit at His feet, to find ourselves saying, Jesus, what are you teaching me in this moment? What are you doing through me in this moment? Status is all about myself, I. How can I do it? The disciples that day, they thought they were on board with King Jesus. They thought, oh, he's rolling into town. Here comes the Messiah. He's going to kick out Rome. And you and I, us 12, we're going to be right here with King Jesus when his kingdom takes power in Israel. And we're going to have a special seat at the table. And Jesus continues to teach, my way is through the cross. My way is dying to yourself, putting your neighbor first, taking the child and loving, or going across to the other side, or going to the sick, the hungry, the lost. That's the way of the kingdom. It's completely counterculture. The kingdom in King Jesus. You are, and you will be, a gift to somebody else. When you leave here, when you leave those doors, you will see somebody else. You'll see somebody out at the gas station or at lunch. You will see somebody tomorrow at school or in your office space, a coworker, somebody. and you will bring them a gift. Let it be grace. Let it be peace. Let it be an offer of forgiveness to them because of what you've experienced by God, through God. Go from this space being somebody that has experienced God's grace and taking it into this world, giving God all glory and all praise now and forevermore. Go into the world being the church, called out to be redeemed and seeking to teach the gospel in all places, at all times. And all God's children say,